So today is March 14th, and would you please introduce yourself to any capacity?
Yes. So my name is Ashley Patterson. I am an associate professor of languages, literacies, and social justice. I have been here at Penn State for, I think this is the end of my ninth year. Yeah. Because I got here in summer 2015. Wild to think, because I did not think I thought I was going to be here this long. I'm a mom of two boys, and a wife and a sister. I have a sister and a brother, and just thinking about the world of like hair journey and stuff, I definitely grew up with hair being a very big part of my life, and also I come from a family that is really, really Black identified, and also most of my family members are on the light scale of the color scale. So I'm among the darkest three or four people in my big extended family, on my mom's side at least, and that has definitely played a part into who I am today as well. Mm-hmm. I'm sure some of the other questions will get more into that.
Definitely. So could you describe a little more about where and when you were born?
Yes. So I was born in 1983 in Detroit, Michigan. But I was only there until I was 12. And even before that, I lived in New York for a little while and New Jersey for a little while. So I moved around a lot growing up, and then I ultimately was in the Atlanta area for 6 years. Before I lived here, that's the longest I've ever lived anywhere, was 6 years. And then I went to college in Boston. And then I lived in Maryland for a little while and taught. And then I went to Ohio for graduate school, and now I'm here. But I say all that to say a lot of that moving around had to do with schooling experiences and stuff. And every time we moved, it was usually for my dad's job. And usually he was moving to a little bit higher paying job, a little bit better job, or moving to a little bit quote unquote better area. And so I was born in Detroit, and the neighborhood we were in was pretty much all Black, and by the time I was graduating high school, we were the only Black family in my neighborhood. In school, all of my formal schooling experiences have been in predominantly white spaces, so from being like the only Black girl in my kindergarten class to my high school was super white. There was a critical mass of Black people, I would say, but it wasn't. There were not enough Black people that I could be discriminatory about who were my Black friends. Like, if you're Black, you get to be my friend. That's it. there's not enough of us. So that's one of the things about being in state college. Like, this is not a very diverse area, but I do feel like I at least have enough people that I can be discerning. And that has been something has grown to be important to me. So when and where I grew up, and I think my dad is born and bred in Detroit, but his parents great migrated up from Oklahoma, and they also went to Langston and HBCU. There's a lot of like Black pride traditions that come through that way. And then my mom's side of the family, she has a lot more racial diversity on her. Like my great grandma on my mom's side, she was the daughter of a house girl and a doctor in Fort Wayne, Indiana, a white doctor, and she ended up getting put up for adoption. Her mom was sent to like a house for loosely moraled women in the South, or whatever, and her dad just like left the town. And she was raised by a black family, and she only ever identified as black. But that's where a lot of the light-skinned phenotype comes from. But still, very, very black identified. So that has always been a part of, even when I was living in places that were predominantly white, I always was coming from a black-centric socialization.
Definitely. So I guess kind of going back again with the difference in phenotype within your family,
mm-hmm.
How did that have an impact on you growing up? Was that a major element contributing to that interaction with your family members?
So I actually think that it wasn't, but the fact that it wasn't was really impactful. So it wasn't really until late high school, college, that I even realized, I don't know, it was a thing that I knew as far as facts go, but it wasn't a thing that like carried a lot of meaning for me. But when my husband came with me to my next cousin up to her wedding before we got married, and after that he was like, I have never been in the same room and in a room with that many light-skinned people in my life. And I was like, what? It just had never occurred to me. And I think part of it, two things reflectively that I look back on, is my mom is really fair-skinned, and she didn't tell me till later, but she really hated that growing up. She got called red bone, yellow, all these things, and she hated it. So she was committed to marrying someone who was like the blackest of black or like Norwegian white, because she wanted her kids to be on one end of the spectrum. And that's not how it works, but whatever. Little did she know. But she was super, super intentional about always complimenting my sister and I about our skin. And my sister is somewhere in between the skin color of me and my mom. But she was always just had nothing but glowing things to say, and very intentionally associated our skin color and just skin with beauty. And I think her siblings all had a similar approach. Like, there was never any favoritism on color lines, or always like very equal compliments and stuff like that. Where most of my cousins are girls, it's just there's eight of us and my brother is the only boy. So a lot of, and when it comes to like genderism, there's different things.
Mm-hmm.
I think though, and also my grandmother, who was super fair, like could pass for white, and even my grandfather, her son, he told me one time that he always knew he was black, but he never like claimed blackness until during the Korean War. He got two draft notices. One, he was marked as black, and one, he was marked as white. And he was like, oh no, we ain't doing that. Now, if I have to claim blackness, that is what it's gonna be for. But he would get chastised for even acknowledging race and color. So it just wasn't something that he passed on to his kids or like talked about. So skin color was not a very organizing feature. Hair, though, absolutely was. And so even some of my more lighter-skinned cousins have more coarse, thick hair than I do, and that sometimes there was a negative light around that. And I was just talking about this in my class this morning. My mom was giving me a perm since I was 4. Mm-hmm. And she wasn't like leaving it in long enough to get stick straight, but she was just like relaxing the curls so that it, and she would say like, well, it's just because you would cry so much when I was trying to wash it, so it just made it easier for me. So that those same types of pride that I grew up with in not only my skin color, but a rainbow of skin colors did not apply to mm-hmm. hair.
Definitely. I think there's definitely that connection between like the idea of embracing the Black identity, but that also has its limitations in terms of like embracing it, but not in the way of your hair or not in the way of your gender mm-hmm. or other things like that, but it's all mainly just like cultural mm-hmm. experience. Mm-hmm. But yeah, definitely.
Yeah, like we would do, my mom would always go make the school let her do like a Black History Month celebration, which mm-hmm. often included myself, but it would be like African dance mm-hmm. and things like that, but it's getting down to the nitty gritty and the nuances. You have to scratch past the surface to get mm-hmm. there, and I don't think they're always super obvious.
Yeah, definitely. So I guess when you were when moving between different spaces and building new communities, mm-hmm. What was that like finding those new pockets of Black community?
Mm-hmm. It was mostly my parents who kind of drove that, but they were always really intentional about us having access to Black people our age. My dad's in a Black fraternity, so that was where a lot of my friends came from. Like my longest friend, my baby's godmother is one of my dad's line brother's daughters. But it was the intentionality on the part of my parents. When we were in Detroit in particular, when I was in, I did all of my elementary school there. My dad made us play like every sport, at least one season of every sport. But we lived in the suburbs by this time, and he would drive us all the way to the city to play for our rec leagues because he wanted us to be around Black kids. And that was like the only time. There was this one white red-haired kid on the team. Everybody else was Black, and that was, I didn't have any other experiences like that. So it was intentionality on my parents' part for the most part. And then by like high school and stuff, when it was my choice more, I always gravitated to people of color, which is different than my siblings. I think because I'm the oldest, so like I said, every time we were moving, a little bit further away from a concentrated Black population. So I don't, maybe my siblings don't have the same yearning or nostalgia for Black community in the way that I did, because that was always a top priority for me, and it never was for them. And they both have white spouses today. I'm the only one of us who has a Black spouse. So I think if I trace it back, that might be where it comes from a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I was trying to think of like my personal experiences mm-hmm. with that, like how there wasn't that much emphasis on like Black identity, at least within my household. So mm-hmm. I tended to gravitate towards more, not really the Black community mm-hmm. as much, but more of a mixed community, okay. Different ethnicities just because in the white school there's like them and then everyone else. So that was mainly my group of friends. But yeah, definitely trying to find that community is also, I guess, difficult in a way. And depending on like the state that you end up into, mm-hmm. it might resonate differently.
Yep. Even in elementary school, like there weren't other black girls, but my group was one girl was Chaldean, and there's a huge like Iranian Christian population in Detroit. So her and then a girl who's from Ghana and a girl who is from India. That was my crew. But again, like the others.
Yeah. Exactly. I think also, I guess kind of like when you went to university, mm-hmm. what was that experience like? Was it kind of similar to when you were like growing up throughout high school, or is it a little different?
It was definitely different for a few different reasons. For one, my blackness, I didn't realize that my blackness is a very like U.S. origins blackness. And when I was in, I mean, that was the case in Detroit and in Atlanta too. Like in Atlanta, I feel like the only, you could be black, white, or Mexican, that's it. Mm-hmm. And not Latino, Mexican. Like those are the racial identities that are open to you. And but when I went to Boston, it was, that was the first time that I had experienced so much multi-ethnic blackness. Like clubs have Rep Your Flag Night and stuff. And I was like, what is this? I just didn't, it just wasn't. I knew an occasional here or there, a person who was Haitian or, but they, I don't know, maybe if they, that was a, even if that was a passionate identity of theirs, I didn't know that. Yeah, there. If I, it would be something that I like randomly learned about somebody, mm-hmm. that they had like ethnic identity. Otherwise, people were just black. But in Boston, that was not the case. Like people are very tied to their ethnic identity, I feel like, and there were a lot of people from New York, who it was the same way. So that was one of the first times that I experienced too, like intra-racism. Like I was dating this Jamaican guy and I was like, so I was actually joking. I don't think it was that serious, but it's like, so am I going to meet your mom? He was like, oh no, I can't take a regular black girl home to my mom. Are you kidding me? I was like, what? I just had never heard this. But I was, again, hyper black involved. I was president of the Black Student Union, doing all stuff like that. They tried to, kick me out of my post at one point because I was too mixy, basically. Like, I was trying to do cross collaborations with both like not black organizations and like the African student organization, and they were like, you're doing too much, basically. Mm-hmm. So, which I've never, I just, I don't know. Mm-hmm. So my blackness was still very much a center of my college experience. But if I think about the four women who I'm most closely in touch with now after almost 20 years of being out of college are two white women and two African women. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I've never really thought about that. I'm sorry.
Definitely. Interesting. But I think you definitely touched on like that, like one of the kind of ignored but big issues within the Black community or the Black space within the U.S. is like that inclusivity
mm-hmm.
between like African Black
mm-hmm.
and then Black African American Black,
mm-hmm.
and I think yeah, like that definitely plays a factor into like how African Americans navigate throughout the U.S.
Oh, yeah.
in different spaces.
Oh yeah,
especially with like what you acknowledged throughout growing up.
That's the first time that I heard someone call me slave Black.
Because
I didn't have it. I was like, oh.
Exactly. Oh.
Here we go.
Interesting.
To say the least. And I actually, my freshman year of college was September 11th.
Mm-hmm.
And I took a year off of college after that and lived in Senegal for a year. And that was another additional layer to the development of my Black identity, because there I was definitely an American before anything else, and people sometimes would take offense when they would ask me like where are your people from, and I'm like, do you know Detroit? No, where are your people from? And I'm like, have you heard of the transatlantic slave trade? Like, I don't know. It didn't come with a map. Like, and sometimes people, I think, would be like, oh, she thinks she's better than us because she's from the United States and stuff. And I'm like, no, there's a disconnect here. Which is, well, yeah, that will take us on a whole different road. But I think that we are oftentimes not encouraged to know about our history, our shared history, because there's power mm-hmm. in that knowledge that I don't think people want.
Yeah.
People who currently have power don't want to be accessed.
Yeah, definitely. I guess kind of circling back to like, I guess your personal upbringing, what was the sentiment surrounding like mental health or mental health access, especially within like the more central Black community?
Yeah, so I didn't know until adulthood that my mom was on antidepressants for most of my growing up, she did not talk about it. We did not. It was not a thing. I don't know that it was a thing she was hiding or just a thing that she wasn't sharing. But her youngest brother died just after my brother was born. And that was a really tough time. But I was only five, but I could see a direct connection between the two things. And then she had a hysterectomy, and they took out everything, so her hormones were really not balanced. I think that contributed. It's like only through therapy now as an adult realizing things like I have a visceral reaction to casserole
mm-hmm.
food. Like, I just cannot make a one baked meal, and it's due to the fact that my mom, that was a unspoken indication that my mom had a bad day.
Mm-hmm.
So if I came home and we were having like tuna casserole or something, I would know that it was gonna be like a trying emotional day. But so though she had coping strategies in place, I suppose, but it was, I have taken a very different approach to mental health and transparency with my kids, and because it was really not talked about at all. And I'm not even sure, I know that my mom has seen a therapist in the past, but I had no idea. My kids know I see a therapist,
mm-hmm.
and my 12-year-old has elected to see a therapist and has just kind of like starting here and okay, I think I've worked through these things, and then a year later gone back, you know. So they have a total different understanding. I don't even think I knew as a child. I didn't have any concept that, and I have anxiety, like clinical levels of anxiety. And in high school, quarterly, pretty much, I would have like a breakdown that would culminate in just like uncontrollable tears, hyperventilation, panic attacks. Really, I didn't realize till later that that's what it was. And my mom would help me work through that scenario, and then I would be like, okay, I'm good for at least 3 months. This will probably happen again. I'll get overwhelmed or whatever, and then I'll just flush it out. And that's what I thought was a healthy cycle, was like, let the pressure build, release the pressure, let it build back up. And retrospectively, my mom should definitely have known. She should have been able to see some of those signs and push in a different direction, but that was not part of standard protocol.
Why do you think there is that apprehension towards like acceptance or sharing of mental health experiences?
I think a lot of it to do it has to do with pride. I think a lot of it has to do with cultural, generational cultural mistrust with the medical world, which that is not really the case for my mom. She like believes really strongly in doctorism. But I think for Black people in general, that's the thing I would say. I think like with the pride, embarrassment, wanting to keep up a certain facade. And I think also Black people haven't had the luxury of self-identifying as having mental struggle. Like, if I acknowledge the fact that the life is hard and it's hard for me to get through the day, then like that's the beginning of the end, because hard. So I think there's this kind of misunderstanding that if you identify that you're like, I've heard a bunch of Black people say before, and I've said before, like, oh, let's not speak that into existence. That kind of thing. Like, if we say it, then it will be. And so we're just gonna have to say it. If we ignore it, it'll go away.
It works, it works. Yeah.
10 out of 10.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I guess then also like with the sense of like pride or resilience, there's also that additional stereotype that comes with it, of like this extreme resilience with especially within Black women, or being able to like do this superhero identity and this girl boss mentality. So what are your thoughts on this perpetuation of these stereotypes?
I know I was really quickly mentioned this in the survey, but I was just my last session with my therapist. I was one of the things we're I'm constantly working on is, so I'm not work-life balance, but work-life equilibrium is what I'm thinking. Because there are, for a lot of different reasons, it seems like a more holistic approach to it, but I'm bad at doing it. I can do it in micro ways, but I was explaining to her, she's still trying to get at the motivations for like why I take on more work than I can. And I can probably honestly handle and stuff. And I was saying one thing is, and my therapist is a Black woman. but I was saying like, if the thing needs to get done, and I get and they the general public gets asked to do it, and nobody agrees to do it, and I know I can do it and do it well, then I often will volunteer to do it. And she was like, who has elected you Wonder Woman? Why do you think this is your your responsibility. And I think some of it has to do with these tropes around Black womanhood and, you know, if you're one of the good ones, then that's because you're strong, you are, you know, all those descriptors you just gave. But I think I know logically, even though I still have a hard time following up this logic with my actions, I know logically it neither benefits me as an individual Black woman, nor my immediate, my small community of my family, nor the broader community of Black women everywhere. None of us, I don't think, are actually benefited by this strong Black woman trope, because what it ultimately means is we overwork ourselves. We are not able to be the beneficiaries in most cases of that work. We're working for other people. And we also, like, one of my favorite Michelle Obama quotes is when she's talking about how she has to be the most important person to herself. Because if she doesn't do the necessary things to keep herself filled up, then she can't pour into anybody else. And this strong Black woman idea demands of you to constantly work on empty. Mm-hmm. And so then you're not able to be a contributor, a maximum contributor to your community. You're not even able sometimes to receive supports that other people are willing to give, because you're so worried on expending all of your energy. So I think it's in some ways like a psychological trick.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Kind of the same way as you were saying, like, not speaking anything into existence. Kind of like, if I can manage, or if I can make myself believe that I can manage everything,
then I can.
Until someone tells me otherwise,
yep,
I'm able to do it.
Yep. Or unfortunately, until there were three Black women during my graduate experience who died.
Mm-hmm.
All 40 plus or minus, one maybe was like a little bit over 40, the other two were right around my age, so like 35, 30, and they were heart issues, and yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot unrelate, or like, there's correlational evidence, not causation evidence, but I mean,
mm-hmm.
come on.
It's pretty strong.
Yes, so. Three?
Mm-hmm.
Just wild.
Definitely. I guess I'll ask two more questions from you.
Mm-hmm.
Was there any point, like, while just going through your life, has there been a point where you believe that the way that you were able to present yourself, at least physically, like with your hair,
mm-hmm.
Has that had an effect on either your confidence within a space, or has that limited you in any way?
Oh yeah, I think that like we when we would get our hair done and stuff as kids, I have vivid memories of my sister and I and my cousins jumping on the couch, chanting, "I'm bouncing and behaving." with our hair pressed out or whatever. So I definitely had a positive association to, like, you know, look good, feel good, do good. And when I wake up and, like, people could tell in high school, if I had a ponytail, then that probably meant I was having a bad day. Like, because
mm-hmm.
that was just the last resort type of thing. And there's a relationship between the two. Like, yesterday I knew I needed to wash my hair, and I had put it off too long, and it was on my mind all day.
Mm-hmm.
And I was still able to get through the day. It wasn't crippling to that level, but it was definitely holding space in my mind. And I don't know if that's true for the average woman. I don't know how hyper specific that is to Black womanhood, but if I'm getting myself together, like if I want to look my best, my hair is definitely not an afterthought.
Mm-hmm.
That's part. I mean, I might organize my whole jewelry and stuff around my hair, or depending on the dress I'm gonna wear, is an updo gonna complement this best? So it's always featured in the whole package when I'm figuring out what I want to do. And I, not anymore, but in the beginning of my career as a professor, thinking about, I don't even know why this was I probably haven't thought about this in years, but this is how the interviews work. I love getting some braids in, and I would not want to start the semester with braids. I just didn't know what the students, I didn't want to color their opinion, pun intended. And I also didn't want to start off with braids and then take them out and have to deal with that whole thing. So, yeah, I used to be very intentional about, like, I need to have at least 4 touch points with these students before I change my hair. I care way less now. I don't know why. I don't know if I'm just becoming old and cranky and I don't care, or if it's because I feel like it hasn't been an issue, but that was definitely a thing that I regularly considered.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
And for like interviews and stuff, I'm not that I will wear my hair straight, but I know that it can be a distraction. So I'm not trying out experimental styles
mm-hmm.
for when I'm meeting strangers typically.
Yeah, understandable. So yeah.
It's ridiculous, but
it's life.
Yeah. especially if I'm doing a long flight, like multiple flights and stuff, I will wrap my hair
mm-hmm.
a lot. And I would have never done that before, like going in public with a bonnet or a, but
there's too much stuff in the world to worry about.
Too many things. Is this really the thing? All that rubbing on the back of your, you need to have protection when you're out in these airplane streets. But
definitely. I think my last question for you is just, how do you think that Black women can impact or inspire the next generation of Black women or just Black adolescents in general?
I think one thing is definitely being explicit in praises about the beauty of Blackness, not only for girls and women, but I'm really intentional about making those praises in front of my sons. I think that I wonder if I had had a daughter, if I would wear my hair differently to, because I often straighten my hair for the ease of it.
Mm-hmm.
I have been, so even this, I think I put this in the survey, like I blow dried my hair, braided it, and this is what it is. But if I had a daughter, I think I would feel compelled to do similar hairstyles.
Mm-hmm.
Like I wouldn't want her to think that her natural hair is good enough, but it's not good enough for me,
mm-hmm.
kind of thing. So, and I also still wonder about if you think that if you buy into the idea that men or boys' first symbol of beauty is their mom, and I don't want my sons to think that straight hair is the only option, kind of thing. So being explicit, taking time to think about these choices you're making and thinking about how they impact, I think can go a long way. I think there's so many things that we do because we have done them, or ways that we think because we have thought them, that need interrogation. So just doing that self-work individually and as a community, I think will help future generations. Like for instance, my grandma, I had my hair like fully like in a maximum big, and my cousin was like, "Oh, that is so cute. I like that." And my grandma was like, "Hey, don't let her lie to you. That does not look cute. You look a mess. You look unkempt. Don't, I hope you're not doing that in public." And it's, I know it goes back to like, she just grew up in a time of decorum, and you know, I always think about the line that Raven Simone had in the Good Hair movie, which is like, relaxed hair makes everybody feel relaxed. And that is definitely my grandma's, you know, which, so I think too, like, interrupting those types of unhelpful thoughts, and there are some things that more on the gender side of things than the hair, but my sister has two daughters and a son, and we've had to have some come to the sides with my mom about these things that she's perpetuating that we don't want. And I know this, in some Black households that would be considered a complete violation. So I think that is another thing, more writ large as a Black community, I think we can do a better job of being critical about the socialization tactics and the communication standards that we have in place, keep the ones that work and are fruitful, and move away from some of these things that perpetuate generational harms. So yeah, self-reflection.
Definitely.
A lot of that.
Yeah. Is there anything that we didn't get a chance to talk about that you wanted to say?
No, I don't think so. I mean, maybe one thing, I was remembering this conversation I had in grad school,
mm-hmm.
Where we were talking something about hair as culture and stuff, and there was another Black woman in the group. Actually, she's one of my super close friends. She's mm-hmm. up here. But she was, and she's really fair-skinned. Her hair is super, super coarse and tightly coiled, and she mostly wore it natural. And I, with straightened hair, was saying my hair is natural, because I hadn't had a perm at that point in years. And she was really, really not okay with my self-labeling as natural hair. And it was just an interesting conversation, and sometimes I wonder about, like, when people are seeking ownership of certain terms, what does that mean? What is it, like, you know, why was I offended from being denied access to this terminology? You know, what does that mean? For, I think we have a lot of similar conversations around like digital activism and stuff, like who gets to say that they are in the fight,
mm-hmm.
basically. And ultimately, I wonder, sometimes I'm way less concerned about like who wins that micro interaction, but what systemic oppressive structures are being fed by us having this contention. Like, because if we're focused on something here, that means that we're not focusing on something else. What is the thing we are not focusing on for us to get there, you know?
Definitely. Yeah, definitely goes back to that whole idea of, like, exclusivity in different spaces.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, also when it comes to, like, defining what different terms means, like, especially with, like, social terms.
Yeah.
It's, like, there's no way to define what it
means. Especially then. They just, a word gets picked up, it gets used all over the place, and it's a telephone game.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Yeah.